Arvoisa seminaariyleisö, hyvät naiset ja herrat, ladies and gentlemen. On the behalf of the National Defense University, I most warmly welcome you all to participate this Russia Seminar 2019 here in Santa Helena, our university's campus. There are only a few free seats remaining, which I think it's a good evidence that our Russia Group seminars are recognized and desirable. And I'm convinced that also this seminar will face your expectations. The topic of this year's seminar, which is the second public seminar organized by the Russia Group of the National Defense University, is Russia's threat perceptions. The objective is to interpret Russia's security threat perceptions as seen in the eyes of the academic community analyzing Russia's security. The topic will be approached from a number of perspectives, including military analysis and foreign and security policy. We will examine Russia, among other things, by taking a look at China, its sizable neighbor. Today, we have also an opportunity to take a look at the Defense Forces Research Agency's fresh analysis on Russia's activities on the cyber world, and extended the analysis to Russia's narrative involving enemy and threat perception lived in the country's history. We obtained speakers for the seminar this year by inviting some of the best experts in field known by us. Thank you for having accepted the invitation. Next year, we intend to increase the openness of the seminar by implementing a so-called open call for papers procedure to attract seminar speakers also from outside of our current network. For next year's seminar, we intend to include methodology for researching Russia's hard security and Russia's military sciences theorists, for example, Alexander Svechin. The work of National Defense University's Russia Group, launched in 2017, is advancing at a good pace. This year, the group will see the number of its posts advancing members increase by two posts. One of them is a senior researcher position, which is one of those 100 additional posts allocated to Defense Forces this year. The other addition to the group is fixed-term civilian doctoral study position with funding from Maanpuolustuksen kannatussäätiö. I want to express my thanks to the resources provided to us. The application period for this position ended at the end of the last month. The applicants were promising. Indeed, the selection and appointment procedure is still going on. The Mannerheim Foundation's long-term support makes it possible to organize this seminar. The seminar organized together with University of Helsinki Alexandri Institute and the European Center of Excellence for Countering Hybrid Threats. I want to express my deepest gratitude for your valuable support to our seminar and to National Defense University. With these words, I open the seminar once again. Welcome to the Russia Seminar 2019. Thank you.
General, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jyri Raitasalo. I'm a military professor of war studies here at the Finnish National Defense University. Also, on my behalf, warmly welcome to this seminar. I have the privilege of being the chair in our first panel dealing with Russian threat perceptions. And as anybody acquainted with strategy knows, how an actor, an agent, in this case Russia, understands and defines security threats is key to understanding how it responds to its security environment, what kind of measures it needs to take and will take today and in the future in order to be and feel secure. So that is why we are dealing in our first session with this first order of questions related to the very core of how Russia works, how it understands security and threats related to its existence. So in the first panel, we start first with a keynote presentation. And after the keynote presentation, I will invite three additional speakers, panelists, to the fore, each of which has a short time to give their own personal ideas about Russian threat perceptions. And after all this is done, we should have a good half an hour or more for Q&A for the audience. So I would encourage all of you here in Santahamina to exploit the avenues and open doors that all of our panelists will surely open when they're giving their presentations. So without further ado, let's get this seminar going. Michael, would you please join me here in front of the auditorium? We start with the keynote presentation that will be given by Michael Kaufmann. Michael Kaufmann is an expert specializing in Russia, Eurasia, and earlier also on matters related to Pakistan. His current research focuses on analyzing defense and military activities in Russia and the area of the former Soviet Union. Michael Kaufmann is a senior research scientist at CNA Corporation, which assists the US military, and he is also a Kennan Institute Fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center. Michael Kaufmann publishes articles in his own blog and on other sites such as War on the Rocks. Kaufmann holds an MA in Security Studies with a concentration in international security from Georgetown University. And as a personal note, I would like to add that if you are going to Washington, D.C. and you want to talk about Russia with somebody who has a clear understanding of what he's saying, you should go to see Michael Kaufmann. I do every time I go to Washington, D.C. Thank you very much, Michael, for being here. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much.
If you don't mind, I might pour myself a glass of water. Well, thank you for that wonderful introduction. Step away from the mic, I tend to be a loud speaker. It's of course an honor to be here for this seminar. I want to thank National Defense University. And it's a great pleasure to be here with you today. I don't have a PowerPoint, so that's the good news. Okay, hopefully what I have to say will be interesting and compelling enough. And more importantly, I recognize I'm in Finland. This is one of the foremost, most knowledgeable place on Russia, and it has many other colleagues and experts I see here from Scandinavian countries and other parts of Europe. You're all to various extents familiar with Russia. You've studied it, you've looked at it. So my goal here is naturally not to lecture, but to hopefully start a good conversation to get us thinking and to get us opened up for the rest of the panel's discussion today. And I'll apologize in advance. I come from the Boston, New York area of the United States where we tend to speak fairly quickly. So I'm gonna do my best effort to meter myself. So, my goal in this conversation is while focusing on Russian threat perceptions, I do want to talk a bit about what I also believe to be fundamental drivers of Russian strategic behavior, that is the inputs in Russian strategy. And the way I'd like to frame it is really kind of three overlapping categories of Russian pursuit of security, how the state defines its theory of how it will attain security for itself, Russian pursuit of power and influence, and elements of Russian strategic culture, which I also think are quite important in that Moscow has a fundamentally divergent outlook on the normative conduct of international relations from that of the United States. And that is also important from a political philosophy standpoint because it leads to a number of frictions and threat perceptions in Russia. Threat perceptions are not just driven by the state's pursuit of security. They're also very much rooted in what the state wants, its ambitions, its drive for power and influence, right? And the more it has and the more ambitious it is, the more problems and challenges it's like to encounter. So we can't just begin this conversation by focusing on how Russia defines vulnerability and security. That said, when I kind of delve into strategic culture, the way I like to think of it, and I hope you'll be willing to take this on board, is it's really about the outlook of the elites. You know, countries aren't people, but they are run by people. People matter. Ideas matter, and how another strategic culture sees the world is fundamentally important besides just the objective pursuit of national interests or security for themselves. And Russian strategic outlook to me over years, I've come to recognize that it sort of represents a fairly firm foundation built like a wall, and it's composed of many, many individual bricks. And that foundation essentially is a general consensus by Russian elite about Russia's role in this region, its place in the world, its contemporary history, and kind of the state's theory of how it should go about pursuing its national interests. And if you go to Moscow, which I do fairly frequently during the year, you will find that on all individual policy issues, you're more than able to debate them with Russians. You can talk about who was right in what conflict and what intervention, who broke which treaty. But at the end of the day, these individual issues are not all that relevant. They are small bricks in a very large, fairly well, firmly built wall, and Russians are more than happy to debate and argue with you on any one of them, but they will not change their overall mind about this big picture on what Russia is, what its role is, what its place is, and what Russian history is. So you are basically arguing over the small little tidbits and features of that much larger, reasonably well-held construct. To be in a conversation, I like to start with the kind of the first three branches of this, which is security. And let's start off with what's very familiar to us, so the argument of geographic determinism that shapes Russian threat perceptions. It's a fairly familiar argument. To me, Russia's challenge principally today in Europe is about revising the post-Cold War settlement in Europe, and that Moscow feels that it fundamentally has no stake in the security framework that has been established in Europe today since the dissolution of the Soviet Union. And Russian elites feel that the current security architecture of Europe was made during a very anomalous period of Russian weakness and Russian absence as being one of the principal actors that shaped European security. To them, the last 20 years in the post-war period was basically something akin to a Treaty of Versailles, that is, Russia had no say in the security framework and is not interested in accepting one that exists. Because from Russian perspective, the current security architecture in Europe is based on a European consensus, it's based on American primacy, it's based on a time of unipolarity when the United States was the unrivaled superpower in the international system, and it's a security architecture where Russian elites feel they don't have a good say in, and for the first time in more than two decades, they feel strong enough and capable enough to challenge it. Russia pursues a somewhat classical strategy of extended defense, more traditional theory of both Soviet Union and the Russian Empire of how to attain security for itself, which is the belief that Russia requires buffers and buffer states for depth, since as the world's largest continental power, it has almost no natural borders, and is not part of any military alliance that, from their perspective, would provide for Russian security needs in Europe. Buffer states are a zero-sum game. They sound like neutral states, but they are not. The only time you really have something like neutral buffer states is when all the parties, all the powers involved, actually concede to the proposition, and they do not in Europe. In reality, buffer states are one country's buffers against the other power. That is, there is a very clear Russian perception looking out to Europe. Either Ukraine and Belarus are Russian buffers against NATO, or they're NATO buffers against Russia. There's no in-between middle ground in this regard. And most importantly, even if you were to conceive of it, fundamentally, the United States and Russia do not agree. That is, the United States would not agree to those countries being considered as buffer states, and neither does Russia. Russia sees fundamentally them as foreposts. And from Russian perspective, the policy of extended defense means that in conception, Russian borders do lie very much in the borders of the former Soviet space. That is where Russian sort of defensive line begins. And this has led to a modern-day Brezhnev doctrine, that is the imposition of limited sovereignty on Russian neighbors and the use of force to check them attempting to leave Russia's sphere of influence, particularly if Russia believes that it will fundamentally lead to them flipping as being a Russian buffer versus a NATO one. That policy became most heavily entrenched from a consensus that emerged after the Great Patriotic War, in Operation Barbarossa in 1941, which is very simply, Russian elite came to believe that the country can never again permit another large-scale industrial war to be held on its territory. Therefore, any contest from Russian perception must be displaced onto the territory of a neighboring state. And for a long time, at least certainly today's Russian elite, has very much come to see NATO as America's Warsaw Pact, and its current borders as principally retreated much more approximating the 1918 Brest-Litovsk Treaty, that is, the borders of the Russian Empire after it collapsed into a civil war in the Bolshevik Revolution. Now, much of the Russian outlook on the security architecture is not driven by necessarily the fear that NATO will attack Russia. You know, paradoxically, the Soviet Union was in such poor shape in 1941 when Operation Barbarossa was launched, precisely because Stalin fundamentally believed that Hitler did not plan to invade the Soviet Union. He was convinced that Hitler intended to create an ultimatum and to force Stalin to trade a substantial amount of land. And there was a lot of German disinformation behind that. But Stalin really wanted to believe that Germans did not intend a full-scale invasion of the USSR, that there was a deal in the making, and that Germany intended to coerce him. The reason I'm raising this point is that this military balance and who is actually the dominant military power in Europe, particularly from Russia's perspective, on Russia's borders, really matters, because it's not about the threat of sudden onset of war, necessarily between the United States and Russia. It is about the threat of coercion, that if a crisis were to take place in Belarus, right, the United States, with conventional military power projection and ability to attain potentially superiority in their European theater, could then effectively coerce Russia. And there is a long-standing fear in the belief of coercion, right? And that power really does matter in competitions of risk-taking and coercive bargaining. And this belief has been generally held. If you follow some of the leading military thinkers, and who are pretty much the intellectual forefathers of many of the people who run the Russian military today, like Mahmoud Gureyev, you can see that there's a congealed sense in the Russian military, actually, that for some centuries, the Russian political leadership has been incredibly successful at making sure that the Russian military starts off almost every war in a completely terrible position, right? And there's a long-standing set of grievances. Forget Russian grievances towards the West. You should listen to Russian general staff grievances towards Russian political class. From Russo-Japanese War to World War II to the Chechen Wars, as to how the Russian military first gets placed by the political leadership at the start of the war, typically in disastrous position, and it really doesn't like it. And this, of course, always leads the Russian military to not only come up with multiple contingency plans and operations, but to always plan for the failure of political leadership to actually have the will and to be in a position to ready the forces to act in the event of a genuine threat. That's why ultimately the Soviet Union developed the perimeter system, the dead hand. So, you know, an automated system for strategic nuclear response. It was fundamentally sort of a plan C or D in the event political leadership wasn't willing to actually go through with a retaliatory nuclear strike. Today's Russia wants to say of the strategic orientation of its neighbors, in part because Moscow sees neighbors historically as liabilities, that as many Russian neighbors from their perspective throughout numerous conflicts have joined whatever great power was invading Russia. So Russian outlook on neighbors is not from a perspective of collective security, necessarily mutual benefit or trade. It is always fundamentally looking at them as potential risks, as states that could serve as plazdarms for the projection of another military power. And at the end of the day, the Russian elite today is very much driven by the fear of further fragmentation. Not just of Russian influence since near abroad, but of Russia itself. There's lots left to lose of the Russian Empire. Russia actually hasn't lost all that much, believe it or not. Russia's by far the least worst loser of the 20th century. Almost all the powers were great powers of 20th century were destroyed or completely lost their empire, fighting in exhaustion. Soviet Empire lost 50% of its population, well less than 40% of its territory. And Russian elites are concerned. They're concerned that the slow process of fragmentation is not necessarily over, that there are still centrifugal forces in play in Russia, and they do fear very much, having stabilized the country, that there's actually still a lot more of Russia to lose. Like Austro-Hungarian Empire, or Ottoman Empire, there's still further cleavages potentially at play. But more importantly, the threat perception that drives a lot of Russian decision-making here is that Moscow continues to deal with the principal fragmentation of Russian influence over the former Soviet space. 100 years ago, the Russian Empire had a problem. It was wedged between two new dynamic and fairly capable rising great powers that didn't really exist before. The first one was named Germany, after it became Germany, and was revisionist. The second was named Japan. Modern Russia today has a problem that's actually not too dissimilar from the Russia of 100 years ago. It is stuck between two very dynamic economic powers. One is named the European Union, and the other one's named China. And both those countries have much greater magnetism, that is, attractiveness of economic systems, of dynamism, of their ability to invest for the European Union, of political values, and the sort of system that advances to other states, to former Soviet states. And so there is an inertia of fragmentation of Russian influence over its near abroad. And Moscow very much blames the United States for what is actually a very logical process of entropy, the natural slow-moving dissolution of its influence, and sees the United States as being instrumental behind a great deal of processes that are actually much more born of the lackluster performance of the Russian economy, a Russian political model essentially being a not attractive model of socioeconomic development for any other country, and for processes innately driven from the European Union, the United States is not behind them. I mean, I wish we were. I always love it when a great plan comes together, but in these cases, it is not so. And this fundamentally has left Moscow, I think, in some ways, a lonely power that doesn't want to be alone. You know, Alexander III's old adage that Russia only has two allies, its army and its navy. Probably for Russia worse. Russia probably has at least three allies, its army, its navy, and Belarus. And it might be better off having just its army and its navy if you have to deal with people like Lukashenko all day long. And every year you're engaged in a rent-seeking negotiation with Belarus as to what it's going to cost for you to keep them in your orbit. But that's the kind of allies that they're left with in terms of states. And, of course, when political, economic, diplomatic means fails, at the end of the day, Russia is always willing to resort to use of force to hold on to its influence. But over years, that always results in a self-fulfilling prophecy with neighbors. Balancing is the most common behavior in international systems. Countries tend to balance much stronger states and powerful aggressors. And of course, over time, as Moscow uses force, Russian neighbors come to see Russia as the most likely threat to their own territory and then begin hedging behavior. And when Moscow then sees them engaged in hedging behavior, trying to build alternative ties and links to the West, Russia begins to coerce them to try and maintain them in its orbit. And that essentially starts to lead to a iterative reaction that results in self-fulfilling prophecies. That is, the more you use force to keep neighbors and friends inside your orbit, the more likely are your neighbors to hedge against you with other powers because they're going to be very scared of you. And last point on this issue. There are a couple asterisks to several former Soviet states. At the top of that list is Ukraine. Russian elites principally had their professional formative years as the last generation of the Soviet Union. Last professional generation. I'm probably personally the last generation of Soviet Union that remembers going to school. But these people are a bit older than me. And I'll tell you, my sense is people's views, particularly policymakers, are principally shaped by two things. And it's not good Russian military analysts. I wish this was the case. Mm-mm. It's the ideology that they have, the belief system. And a lot of times it's not necessarily their ideologies. It's an old adage that most people don't have ideas. Ideas have people. And the second is their professional formative experience, their 30s and 40s, the time they spent in government, when their views shaped, after which they no longer became very impressionable. That is, when they began to acquire a clear outlook on the world based on their professional experience. And the people in charge of making decisions in Moscow at the end of the day are all from a generation. And that generation's formal professional experience was in the latter years of the Soviet Union. And when it comes to countries like Ukraine, they simply cannot conceive and do not look out on these countries as independent states. They do not see the conflict between Russia and Ukraine as an interstate conflict. They see that as something of a familiar internal dispute between former successor states of the Soviet Union, but does not really appreciate Ukraine as an independent national state and will always have a hard time doing so. It's actually much harder, believe it, for continental land powers than it is for people who had overseas colonies, because you have an elite running a country, and they look out the window, and they see lots of countries that used to actually belong to them, and they used to be in charge of them. In fact, they're so used to them, they run foreign policy towards a number of these countries, not through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but from the presidential administration, which is very telling, okay? Because it says that the country's political culture has not yet really accepted the fact that these are really independent states. But let me turn away from security. Let me turn a bit towards power and influence. Great powers, life is not about just security, vulnerability, perceptions. It's about wanting more. And great powers particularly tend to grow hungrier from the eating. Success begets success. So Moscow strongly desires recognition as a great power. We know that. Not restoration of itself as a great power, but recognition. Believing that being a great power does not come with responsibilities in the U.S.-created liberal international order. It comes with privileges, right? And does Russia intend to restore itself as the dominant regional power in the former Soviet Union, right? In its own near abroad? Russian belief on great power is quite interesting and I think noteworthy. One, she believes that it's hereditary great power. As Russia is a great power because it is Russia, has a special place in the international system. Its father was the Soviet Union, the Soviet Union's father was the Russian Empire. They were all great powers or superpowers. But she does not believe great power status derives from some objective measurement of economic performance. You know, when we try to see how big people's population is, how big their GDP is, their military power is. No, this is hereditary inherited status. And that is their belief. And their job is getting that recognition. Part two is Russia believes there's a providential power. And this I always found interesting because not all countries have a providential mission. As an American, I recognize quite well, the United States also believes it's a providential power with a special mission in the international system. And what is Russia's special mission? Well, believing it's a providential state, Russian leads do have a vision, a story they tell themselves that lends coherency to the pursuit of national security policy and objective interests. There's a narrative that ties it together. That narrative, interestingly, is actually very much based on the United States. It's actually Russian view of its role in international politics is inseparable from Russia's views of America's role in international politics, which is why, first and foremost, Russia needs recognition from the United States. Not, I'm sorry to say, not necessarily from Finland, not necessarily from Portugal, and not necessarily from most of the countries in the international system. What they cannot live without is recognition from the United States. Russia believes that the second principal nuclear weapon state international system, it has inherited a special responsibility for international security from the Soviet Union. That is a shared responsibility to the United States, and in that regard, they see themselves as equals. And Russian elites are very focused on nuclear weapons as a determinant of status. Second narrative that has emerged more recently, which is Russia sees itself as a conservative status quo power, whose mission it is de facto to check American interventionism, revisionism, and use of force to conduct regime change abroad. As Russia sees itself as the advocate for a conservative nation-state system. And it has come up with this vision for itself very much as a mere reflection of what it believes to be U.S. foreign policy conduct. That is, it is based off of how Russia sees America's role in the international system. Now, recognition is an end, of course, an end in and of itself for Russian elites. All people want to be recognized. But it's also an important dialectic. From Russia's perspective, if you accept that Russia is a great power, then you must also accept that Russia has a privileged sphere of influence, that it has legitimate security concerns, and it has right of arbitration with other powers in international systems. Now, I'll get this in just a little bit. Yeah, and of course, if you accept that, then you should also accept that, well, actually, yeah, Russia has some legitimate security considerations, and there's causes for what it's doing in Ukraine, and et cetera, and competing for Russian buffer states would mean an intolerable security loss for it and whatnot. So, as a result, there's a narrative that's formed in Moscow that essentially the current state of confrontation, U.S. sanctions, use of economic instrument of national power to coerce and punish Russia, that they are de facto being punished for what they feel is conducting an independent foreign policy international system, challenging the United States. They do not see sanctions and Western retaliation as a response to their behavior. That's actually not at all uncommon. It's very common in actually strategic cultures. Policy communities very typically ascribe the other side's behavior not as a response to things they have done, but state that is innately driven, just another step in the other side's aggressive strategy to contain them and to constrain them and to deny their sort of legitimate interests. And as an escalation unfolds, often both sides begin to tell each other the exact same story, that they're not engaged in an iterative cycle of escalation and punishment and coercion, that both sides are driving their foreign policy from a strategy they had from the very beginning, and they paint the other side as sort of being inherently aggressive. And that's the way Russia looks out in the United States today, and it sees this very much as a continuation of the Cold War. In fact, it is impossible for me to have a panel discussion like this in Moscow without at least one person during the Q&A telling me that the Cold War never ended. Now, of course, Russia wants to sit on all the governing institutions governing the international order as a system determining power, be part of all negotiations, contact group, be in a good position to advance interest block adverse policy. That's understandable, right? But Moscow sees the United States very much as a fundamentally revisionist country expanding a liberal international order. And very importantly, it sees the European Union very much in the same way. And European Union is, of course, very much a product of a shared European political vision and a European strategy. But it is also part of America's grand strategy for Europe, for peace and stability in Europe as well. And Russians recognize that, that NATO is not the only organization the United States and American policy elite for a very long time has seen as one of the principal benefits and strategies for a safe, peaceful European order. European Union is also part of, has always been a part of that agenda. I would make you the argument that increasingly from Russian perspective, the European Union is a bigger threat than NATO. And I've come to see that over time. NATO as a challenge to Russia has always been a conversation about the United States and about the projection of American military power in Europe, using the European landmass and being able to project conventional military power into Russia. European Union, to me, is a much bigger strategic challenge and a much more fundamental one. It's driving a great deal of processes in terms of fragmentation of Russian influence. It's near abroad that the United States simply is not. Next, I'd like to turn to the third bit, which is a more strategic and fundamental difference in normative outlooks. That is how we see the world and how we see the conduct of international relations. This is not an ideological difference, but it's a very fundamental one. Because I hope once you hear it, you'll see one of the root drivers of Russian behavior. So, you know, Russia is a particular political philosophy. And it's somewhat retrograde classical view. It's a great power that only great powers have sovereignty in the international system. Middle states and small states all have limited sovereignty to some extent, especially those that are allied to great powers. And so great powers, from Moscow's perspective, are primus inter pares. They are first among equals. They have special privileges. Their special privileges include a legitimate zone of security interests, privileged sphere of influence, the right of arbitration of their disputes with other great powers, like the United States, over the head of smaller states. Now, of course, the right to sit on all the key institutions governing the international order. But part of this belief stems from the Russian view that the most important thing in international security is stability relations between great powers because there are nuclear weapon states, that is, to avert another great power war. This is a very strongly held belief. It is also a very self-serving one. Because if you are in charge of a country that is not economically dynamic and does not make necessarily good use of its human capital, but you are one of the dominant nuclear powers in the international system, you will see that this is a very effective way to validate your position in the international system and your argument for the recognition that you desire. So from Russia's perspective, it is not simply that Ukraine is somehow unique as a country, that they think Ukraine has limited sovereignty. In Russia's view, actually, all states that aren't great powers have limited sovereignty. And their sovereignty and their ability to independently determine strategic orientation is subordinate to a much larger prime directive, security interests of great powers and avoiding another great power war. And Russia will often advance this point of view because it's actually fairly deeply held. It also serves their interests very well. You know, the two go together. The U.S. has a very different view of international politics. It's not just about not accepting spheres of influence. One of the big benefits of this international order from the U.S. perspective is that actually small powers and middle states genuinely can't choose their strategic orientation. More importantly, while Moscow really cherishes the primacy of the state, the United States has a fairly deep ideological belief in the sovereignty of the individual, human capital, and the expression of political will through democratic systems. This political dialectic has very, very important ramifications, okay? Because Moscow has come to believe, okay, that there is a genuine design in the United States to change the Russian regime. That U.S. foreign policy is fundamentally missionary, because it believes in the sovereignty of the individual versus primacy of the state, and that the U.S. does not see countries where the will of individual is not expressed, i.e. authoritarian systems, systems based on personalized rule, as having legitimate political system, and in times of confrontation and contradiction, U.S. does not see those countries as having legitimate interests, but instead declares those interests to be the policies of the regime, not in the interest of the public that is leading. So, the Russian takeaway is that the U.S. will always see the purpose of its relationship with Moscow as regime conversion. And the system of personalized rule and formal patronage networks can never separate its own survival from that of the state. It is the state in its own conception. There's no difference. Right? And so Russian leadership does not and will not see the state's interests as separate from its own interests. And what you basically get in a scenario is that if Russia elite only does not see small middle powers as having sovereignty, it also perceives that the United States does not think that authoritarian powers and authoritarian regimes are fundamentally sovereign either, because they don't express the legitimate interests of their people. And so that this becomes a much more fundamental confrontation, and over time they basically come to understand that United States, that they will not be able to have any sustainable relationship with the United States, any strategic partnership, because the United States pursued this principally one of regime transformation and is a missionary one at its heart. Let me summarize what I think Russian elites have settled on in terms of what they actually want to get out of the United States and sort of the end goal dream of this confrontation. It was, most of all, Moscow wants a deal. It wants a very particular deal. It wants a very particular recognition. And wants a place and respect from a very specific time. It's a deal that the Soviet Union got from the United States during the period of detente from 1972 to 1979. Soviet Union was by far the weaker of the two superpowers. It was not a competition of equals in any respect of the word. But the Soviet Union did very well in the first 20 years. That's why détente actually became a policy. It did quite well against a much stronger opponent. And the Russian view is that the Soviet Union, being ideologically crazy, refused to take yes for an answer at a time when economically it was dying and it competed itself to death. But from Russia's perspective, the Soviet Union got a very good deal. It got de facto recognition as co-equal superpower, which it was not. It got legitimacy for its interests in a territory it took in Europe from the United States. Not so many words, but yes. And it got a fairly stabilized, it was able to stabilize the competition against a much stronger power. And so the Russian dream was to get a similar deal from the United States, and very much the way the Soviet Union got its. Not on the basis of the actual balance of power, not on the basis of success of competing economic systems or political ideas, but on actual performance in the competition. There's the amount of coercion, the amount of pain, and successful gambits in international politics that they're able to affect. And from Russia's perspective, while it's very disadvantaged, it's not nearly as strong as the Soviet Union, it has one thing that the Soviet Union did not have. It has China. The Soviet Union did not have a much larger Soviet Union competing with the United States at the same time. And Russian elites believe that over time, to the extent they can help empower China, that China being proving a much larger, more capable competitor to the United States will eventually force the United States down the line to make a deal with them. And that deal will not be a public or principled acceptance of a privileged Russian sphere of influence, of legitimate Russian security interests, but it will be a de facto acquiescence to that reality. At least that's their hope. And of course, they dream of renegotiating the post-Cold War security arrangements in Europe. But that is essentially the end goal of the strategy, and they think that if they can successfully compete into the 2020s and be a big enough strategic thorn in America's side, they could eventually wear the United States down and get such a deal. Now, as I wrap up kind of with the last 2 points. Jure, I don't know how much time I have. I'm going to look at you and watch your body language. Thank you. I'm going to see how anxious you look looking back at me, because I don't know if I'm running out. We turn to domestic politics. So in all these conversations when Russians talk about threat perceptions, we understand there's a degree of instrumentalism. And Russia has a very long track record of surviving a confrontation and building resilience by mobilizing the population. And that, of course, does require mobilizing political will and engaging in a degree of rhetoric at home. But it's very important, as my perspective, not to assume that people do not believe what they say. Both are true. There's always an inherent public message in Moscow aimed at a domestic audience to mobilize it as part of this confrontation. But there are also fairly deeply held beliefs within this range. Some are harder to the right, some are a bit to the left, but they're fairly well bounded. You know, as I leverage Steve Kotkin's work, who I think is a great historian, one of the things you find out, particularly as archives are open in the 1990s, is if you go back to the early decades of the Soviet Union under Stalin, you will find remarkably something that was fairly obvious, which is it turned out that the communists were really communists and actually believed in communism. And that ideology really did shape heavily the first 30 years of the Soviet Union and a lot of Stalin's decision making. And I use this as an example of people do not believe that Russian elites simply say these things, but behind closed doors, they have a private meeting with a totally different set of PowerPoint bullets. In my very limited professional government experience, I have found, and this, by the way, is another source of misperception, certainly between the United States and Moscow, that ideological elites tend to be far more ideological and private behind closed doors in government meetings than they are in public. In fact, the ideology is more deeply held, it's more overt, and views are stated much more clearly, if anything, rather than muddled down and becoming cynical. So in any case, as a word of cautionary conservative analysis, I think you should very, very much take Russian elites at their word many times when they discuss their threat perceptions and what they intend to do about them, and not simply dismiss them as a form of dialectic propaganda or just a vehicle for internal mobilization. That's always there, but both in many ways are true. Let me turn briefly to the Russian military and Russian military thought. Right, because this is one part I do want to cover, and this part of the reason we're, of course, here is to discuss military matters. What are Russian military threat perceptions? So, Russian military has had the opportunity to really, really study and admire the problem of great power war for the last 20 or 30 years. U.S. has been very busy, very operational, fighting a great deal of conflict. Counterterrorism, stability operations, adversaries with no escalation dynamics, principally wars of choice. Russians have had considerable military experience, but they've been very much focused on the problem of great power conflict. What looks like the United States, what looks like China, and as always have a very, very strong tradition of strategy, of discussing what the current character of war is and what the future of warfare holds. And that debate from my perspective very much shook out like this. The Russian military believes the U.S. way of war fundamentally is airspace blitzkrieg and decapitation strike, and that this warfare is based on approaching contests between countries as a contrast between military and political systems. As the United States got out of the business of warfare by attrition of manpower and materiel decades ago, since the 1980s, and that the decisive period of war is the initial period of war, and the way U.S. conducts campaigns reflects that in the first couple of weeks, it becomes very clear who was right and who was wrong in terms of the decisions that were made. And that today, contests between states are contests first and foremost between political systems based on political will and resolve. And Russians believe that the most important thing there is an asymmetry of interests at stakes and their ability to manipulate risk and to manipulate countries' perception of the amount of pain and risks they're willing to take in pursuit of what Moscow typically believes is a contest where its interests at stake. It cares a lot more over the object in question. And military systems, which is that war is principally a fight between two military systems that have nodes and subsystems. And if you're effective at disaggregating them, then you can essentially destroy the adversary's ability to fight. So it breaks down to two things: attacking the adversary's ability to fight and attacking the adversary's will to fight. In Russian view, there are two important evolutions that have taken place, really since 1980, the last decade of the Cold War. And all these debates were held during the martial Agarkov period of 77 to 84 as well, kind of the height of Soviet military thought. The first is U.S. pursued an independent conventional war option. That is, in the early 1980s, the United States basically broke with the suicide pact it had with the Soviet Union on nuclear escalation and was looking for a way to be able to win a limited conventional war only against the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union found this incredibly worrisome, and Russia finds it still very worrisome today. And that led the United States to develop what Russians call a strategic conventional triad, based on long-range precision-guided weapons, cruise missiles, missile defense, and point-to-point systems like Prompt Global Strike. Russia has never accepted the proposition of a conventional-only war with NATO or the United States. They've always assumed that this war would be nuclear, and have always invested heavily in theater nuclear warfare and strategic nuclear warfare. The big difference today from Russian perspective is while the United States has chosen to believe that a conventional-only war is possible, Russians have chosen to believe that a theater-only nuclear war is possible, that there's a possibility of limited theater nuclear exchange without escalation to strategic nuclear exchange. And that, in part, is very much their answer to conventional superiority. Russian elites and military thinkers believe that the United States today pairs political warfare, subversion, and information warfare together with high-end capabilities such as precision-guided weapons at the final phases of the conflict to intervene and destabilize a state. The military talks about this all the time, although they have to pay lip service to political warfare and political subversion. Russian General Staff, from my perspective, fundamentally believes in the efficacy of hard conventional military power and sees political warfare as a very important feature, but not necessarily a decisive aspect of war. And this led Russian military thinkers to basically conclude that today, modern conflict is going to be short. Yes, it'll start undeclared. And so the most important periods of war are the threatened period of war, the crisis leading up to the conflict, and the initial period of war. An initial period of war is a high-intensity fight with long-range standoff weapons. And beyond the initial period of war, there's not going to be any other period of war, okay? I mean, the period after the initial period may be simply a theater nuclear exchange, and that'll be that. But there's not a Russian belief that modern warfare with a country like the United States or China will be long. And Drew, I see you now looking at me intently, so I'll wrap up with this point. From my perspective, Russian military force structure and posture is fundamentally governed by the philosophy to be postured around counter-surprise. And when you hear Valery Gerasimov, the Chief of General Staff, talk, and he lays out the concept of preemptive neutralization and active defense, what he's really laying out is the long-standing belief in Russian military thought that if they believe absorbing a first strike is not a viable option for them, and they believe that an adversary attack is imminent, then their best option is preemption, and to strike first. And I'll tell you that historically, states will take considerable risk rather than live in perpetual insecurity. And so from Russia's perspective today, the current state of confrontation is not war, but it is a period of danger, right? And from their view, this is sort of the first half of what they consider to be the threatened period of conflict. And they have two identified triggers for escalation and preemption. One, perception of an imminent attack based on U.S. force posture, maneuvering, and signaling in Europe, that is actual U.S. conventional force in Europe. And second, no less concerning, internal instability in Russia that they believe to be a form of political warfare paired with external support from a country like the United States. That is what they believe will be a political warfare campaign that eventually will be followed up by eventual employment of conventional military power. So, on that happy note, I'd like to conclude at least my part of the presentation. I hope it was interesting. Turn it over to lovely fellow panelists. I think you have some equally brilliant analysts here coming up. Jury, if you could, please take us.
Thank you, Michael, for the very analytical, rich presentation from three perspectives, touching strategic culture, power and influence, and normative outlooks, and there will be many themes that we can continue on discussing and have your questions on, for example, on the notion that the European Union is a much bigger long-term threat or a challenge to Russia than the NATO. I think that doesn't conform with the very traditional notions that we have. Also, the very notion that that Russia wants a particular kind of deal with the United States. So I think that is also one avenue to go. And also, what will war look like if we ever get to war in Europe, based on your analysis? So I would like to now ask the rest of the three panelists to the floor, please. Take your seats. So we will have short presentations by the rest of the three panelists. I will present them briefly, and then we will hear their presentations, and then I will hand over the floor to you in the audience. So next to Michael, we have Daivis Petraitis, who works in the Ministry of Defense of Lithuania as a senior advisor in the Department of International Relations and Operations. He's a retired officer in the Lithuanian Armed Forces. He also works as an independent analyst on different defense and security topics. His main area of interest and research is Russian military matters, the area where he spent more than 20 years of research and analysis, both as a military analyst and as an independent researcher. Then next to Davis, we have Gudrun Persson. She is the Deputy Research Director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Program at the Swedish Defense Research Agency, FOI, and an Associate Professor at the Department of Slavic Studies in Stockholm University. She focuses on Russian security policy and Russian military strategic thought. She holds a PhD in government from the London School of Economics. Gudrun Persson lectures regularly at Stockholm University and Uppsala University, and has published widely on Russian affairs, including 4 monographs. She is a member of the Royal Swedish Academy of War Sciences. And finally, the fourth panelist today in this morning panel is Petteri Lalu, Lieutenant Colonel, military professor. He is the head of Russia Group here at the Finnish National Defence University. His areas of expertise are the Russian art of war and Russian military politics. Lalu obtained his Doctor of Military Sciences degree from the Finnish National Defence University in 2014 and has been an active duty officer in the Finnish Defence Forces ever since 1990. He completed his General Staff Officer course in 1999. Petteri's military experience includes several positions in the ground-based air defence, military intelligence and strategic research. So now, ladies and gentlemen, we start with short commentaries, 10 to 15 minutes each, and we start with in the order of a program. So Gudrun, the floor is yours.
Right, thank you. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I want to thank the organizers, and it's a great privilege to be in this knowledgeable setting to discuss my take on Russian threat perceptions. In a time when it's said that Russia is unpredictable and even an adhocracy, to my mind it's worth analyzing the threat perceptions, the more constant features of Russia's threat perceptions, because it does tell you something important about Russia's actions and military capability. And this is essential to my mind so that more nuanced policies about deterrence and engagement can be developed. First, I will touch on very briefly on the development of the current threat perception here and now, and then about the development of doctrines and strategies to meet these threats. Particularly, I will pay attention to the domestic situation, which is also a driver to my mind, and the learning process from past and current conflicts. As you will notice, this will be largely some notes about Russian self-image and self-identification in these times. Кто мы? Who are we? So the military theoretical debate has largely for the past 25, 30 years reflected the great changes, i.e. the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the reduction of Russian territory, particularly in the western parts, and globalization and the technology development. The search for a national identity in later years becoming a policy of patriotism has its equivalent in the military strategic debate and the search for a new Russian military strategy. As Michael said, all the various conflicts reaching from Desert Storm to Iraq and Libya, and of course Russia's own experience from the wars in Georgia, Ukraine and Syria are persistently discussed. Now, Russia developed its main current doctrines and strategies throughout the 1990s. Since the first draft of the military doctrine in 1993 up until now. And if you study those closely, you can see that already by the year 2000, the anti-Western view had become persistent in the doctrines. And I'll just go through the persistent threats very quickly here. The main persistent threat is NATO eastward expansion. It's called unacceptable already in 1997. Another persistent threat is the unipolar world based on domination by Western countries under the leadership of the United States. It is described in 2000 in the National Security Concept as NATO's transition to the practice of using military force outside its zone of responsibility and without the UN Security Council sanction. And Russia has, since the 90s, emphasized, the mid-90s, late 90s, emphasized the need to work for a multipolar world, first promoted by Foreign Minister Yevgeny Primakov in the 90s. Which is a world dominated by interaction between different poles where no single power should be allowed to threaten the status quo and Russia's right to a privileged sphere of interest. In addition, a sense of being ignored is also persistent in these documents. Again, the National Security Concept of 2000 talks about how Russia shouldn't be ignored. The military doctrine likewise notes that a military threat is the effort to ignore, violate Russian national interest in solving international security problems, which also echoes of what Putin said in 2018 when he had all these video presentations of the different weapon systems. You didn't listen then. Will you listen now? Furthermore, a persistent threat since Kosovo is the use of military means to achieve regime change. The military elite saw Kosovo as a template of NATO's future actions. And the foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov, as late as yesterday in the security conference in Moscow, reminded of the 10-year anniversary of the Kosovo incident. It's still a threat. Actually, if you allow me a footnote, in 1999, I was in a seminar in England at the time where there was a Russian delegation under a vice defense minister, and they all walked out when it happened. Also present in these documents is an awareness of a technological gap where Russia is lagging behind the West. To sum up, it reveals a following consistent perceived threat assessment. Externally, NATO eastward expansion, missile defense, regional and local wars on Russia's borders, international terrorism and radicalism. The internal threat assessment can be summarized in the following points: violation of the unity and territorial integrity of the Russian Federation, attempts to change the constitutional structure by force and also by NGOs these days, economic instability, foreign intelligence services, foreign organizations, and color revolutions. My point here is that it's been clear that the anti-Western, the projection against NATO, as Michael put it, has been consistent over the years. Now, in terms of domestic drivers, very briefly, currently domestic and external threats are increasingly seen as linked to each other. And the chief of the general staff, Valery Gerasimov, has repeatedly noted the blurred limit between war and peace, between offensive and defensive operations. This is being done, of course, at a time when the Russian search for an identity evolves around patriotism, consisting of a strong state, strong Russian Orthodox Church, and strong armed forces. It is indicative to me that the military doctrine not only talks about deterrence and nuclear capabilities, but also about the role for the armed forces to defend, quote, historical, spiritual, and patriotic traditions within the defense of the fatherland. Now, learning from the past, to meet these threats, doctrines and strategies are being developed. Now, the debate, military debate, revolves around questions like whether the character of war has changed fundamentally. The answer is yes, currently. The relations between military and non-military means, the importance of non-nuclear deterrence in relation to nuclear deterrence, and the role of color revolutions in contemporary warfare. In doing this, many of the Soviet and Tsarist military thinkers of the past are being rediscovered, with names like Dmitry Milyutin, Mikhail Dragomirov, Genrikh Lehr, Alexander Svechkin, Yevgeny Messner, Tukhachevsky, Iserson, etc. Here I'd like to stop a bit with Dmitry Milyutin, that is Alexander II's war minister, responsible for the military reforms in the 1860s and 70s, which ended in general conscription, or a variant of that was introduced. The reason I'm doing this is that he is being increasingly rediscovered in Russia. And Nikolai Makarov, the previous chief of the general staff, 2008 and 2012, one of the brains about behind the current military reform. In his memoirs that came out a year ago, also, he highlights the importance of Dmitry Alexeyevich Milyutin. And he quotes Milyutin's last article from 1912, the year of Milyutin's death, by the way, and claims that it could have been written today. In the article, Milyutin writes about the need for improved military material, for specialized branches of weapon. He notes that war now, that is 1912, breaks out suddenly and unpredictably in spite of international agreements. And he worries about the great technological gap between Russia and Europe. As mentioned, the awareness of a technological gap where Russia is lagging behind the West is one of the persistent in the current threat assessments. And in order to cope, Russia has obviously launched two major armament programs. Makarov also quotes Milyutin when he writes about the need to focus on military education from commanders to soldiers, where a balance has to be found between military discipline, the growing need for personal initiative, and unconventional actions. So when Gerasimov today talks, based on the Syrian experience, about the importance of commanders to make non-standard decisions, employ military cunningness and deception, to be able to act unexpectedly, it not only echoes from the past, but it also, more importantly, shows that the current military leadership is standing on the shoulders of its predecessors. So I'll start wrapping up. Now, the modernization of the Russian armed forces over the past 10 years is producing results, and military capability has increased. At the same time, challenges are substantial. However, more importantly, then and now, it's about more than technological innovations and new weapon system. In the mid-19th century, universal conscription was considered necessary in Russia, and soldiers needed education in order to act more independently on the battlefield. Today, from a Russian perspective, fundamental questions are raised about how to motivate future generations to fight and for what. Now, thoughts and doctrines to future challenges and threats needs to find a balance between the perceived threats and the resources available to meet those threats. It's a given. Therefore, political support is essential in any country and in any time. Now, the authoritarian political system with a strong figure at the top is described as the right one for Russia, feeding into the tradition of Russian great powerness. In the long-term perspective, it might be useful to look at an historical experience regarding strategy and policy. In the late 19th century, according to an American historian, William Fuller, two incompatible features resulted in a mismatch between Russia's strategy and policy. On the one hand, the strategy was characterized by an excessive sense of military inferiority, and on the other, a reluctance to accept any diminution in Russia's international standing and prestige. And this, according to William Fuller, led to an avoidable overextension. But rather than to recognize this, Russia overstretched with disastrous consequences. And this is something worth remembering for the future and for the Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gudrun. Petri, you're up next. Sorry, I had to speed up a little bit. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, as a simple military man, I have only three options here on the slide. There's three military threat postures I would like to stress on. The first one is a strategic nuclear strike option. That was, for me, it was a zero option until last year. These clouds and mushrooms, they are reminiscent from the Cold War era. And they have stayed, underlying between the relation of United States and Russia after the collapse of Soviet Union. They have not vanished away, but they have not been so much on talks. But last year, they popped up. And the development in Russian has gone that way that
Russia has developed these delivery methods of nuclear armament constantly, silently, but not in secrecy. But this talks about this thing started in President Putin's toy show on March 2018. And also he mentioned how nuclear weapons would be used in a combat situation last fall in his panel discussion in Valdai Club in Sochi. And besides giving lots of his thoughts of eschatological theology, I think he wanted to stress out that Russia is not going to start a nuclear strike, but if attacked, it will attack back with a launch and warning based system. So that means at that time the missiles are arriving towards Russia, they would launch missiles back. The reason for this, I think it's mainly with this current situation with the arms limitation talks. All the actions around this mushroom clouds are very disappointing, I think, for the Russians, and they consider there are only actions by United States. And now, when the INF treaty is going to end, and the next one might be the START treaty, I think they have this need to put this up on the table and start discussing about this. And this is the way to get recognition from the United States, and perhaps this is also the way to have this so-called acceptable deal with the United States. The second one here, air blitz. It's a nice word because it's a very short aerospace massed missile strike towards Russian systems, maybe for the decapitation of nuclear systems or other important systems for Russian army, armed forces, or other important Russian systems. And this threat scenario, when I'm talking about people with this, people say, hey, are you mad? No one would like to attack Russia on that way. I would put out that classically we think about what threat is, that threat is a potential multiply with will. I would put it that way, that threat is potential plus will. Because if we use this multiply with will, we will end up with a situation that if there's a zero will, there is a zero threat. So I don't think that that kind of situation is possible. But potential plus will might play better. Russians have prepared for this with significant efforts on their integrated air defense systems. And also, I think, and I interpret their SNAP exercises that they started publicly 2013, they are one part of this defense against air blitz. I see this as a classical evasive action, which is part of Russian military arts action to evade attack. So they don't want to sit in their military installations to wait for American cruise missiles that are launched from the Arleigh Burke class destroyers. And what follows after that, it's mostly very conventional military operations, redeployment for the counterattack, or if that's not available, because Russia sees itself still a little bit not paired with West, these things, the options might be also indirect or asymmetrical. And Russian military theorists have mentioned possible options, for example, making some kind of industry-related problems with special operation troops, perhaps blowing up dams or something like that. Or it could be also the tactical nuclear option in that kind of situation that's not ruled out. The third one, color revolution. When I first heard about this word, this image came to my mind, and there's some kind of unicorn, and there is lots of colors of rainbow, and it was related for some kind of liberal thinking and homo, gay, lesbian propaganda. I think that's one part of this threat image, and I agree totally with that idea that the EU might be a bigger challenge, a political challenge, than NATO, because NATO is just, it's just a military alliance, but NATO, European Union, is political. It has multiplicity of vectors, if so thought in Russia. I think that today Russian theoretic writers they admit that this theory of class of civilizations might be reality. There are a couple of writers which are referred today very much in Russia. First one is Danilevsky. He's from the 18th century, 19th century writer. Then we know Huntington very well. He wrote his theories in 90s, this and gave name to this theory, class of civilizations. And also one of the supporters in Russia is Alexander Dugin. But it's interesting that Danilevsky is now getting more and more citations in Russian writings, and this his thoughts on how Russia is in relation with Europe are very similar what we see today. And how to deal with this kind of situation? One writer, Yevgeny Derbin, he's a retired general. And he writes in the Vestnik Akademie Vojennych Nauk paper, and his resolution for this is, it's a confrontation for 100 years, how Russia will cope this situation. And the main thing against color revolution is then informational protection of Russian people, so they won't get these wrong kind of colors of in their thoughts, perhaps. Gudrun mentioned this technical gap. It has used to be the third, my third option, but there was no space on this on the slide. I think Russians in the beginning of 90s, when they saw these Persian Gulf operations, and also saw and witnessed operations in Kosovo, they noticed that the opponent's technology was far beyond advanced comparing to their own, and I think in their heads is always a fear that kind of surprise might attack them later on. Beyond these military threats, I would stress out one thing: what was on the slides of previous chief of Russian General Staff, General of Army Nikolai Makarov, on 2011, and when he pointed out what are the most worse threats against Russian military security, the first one was the European efforts on energy self-sufficiency. And when we now after the IPC report, witnessed this new boom, political boom in Europe and also in the United States, perhaps. And it will lead to, might lead to a situation that no one won't be willing of to buy Russian energy, for example, in after 30 years. And I would like to ask how Russia is getting ready for this kind of situation, because their whole economy is based on buying gas and selling gas and selling oil to the other countries. And the simple answer can't be that Nord Stream 2 pipeline will settle this out. It's not sufficient for that. And I don't know if Russia is thinking of any other options that might help Russian economy after anyone is not so willing to buy any carbon-based products. So I end up with this and go back with slides to get them ready for Davis. Thank you.
Thank you, Petteri. Davis, you're up next. Davis is going to have some slides, so if you want to see them, Michael, you can also take a seat in the front row. Yeah. That's okay.
Are there going to be a lot of slides?
Thank you very much. Guess I'm going to be the only one who is going to kill you by slides. I do apologize, those slides are fragments from my presentations, which I do in military academies, having entire course on Russia. But my talk would be different, so it would be for you just to get my arguments faster. And I'm not going to concentrate on military threats and how Russia sees military threats, because it was already mentioned here, and at the same time the topic of the seminar is more related to the hybrid. So I will concentrate my presentation, my speech on so-called hybrid part of the world of soft powers, of soft forces, of soft methods, different warfares Russia is adopting. But before I start, I want to say one very important thing, which I'm truly confident that it's true. Russians are different. They have different military philosophy. They have different way of doing things. They have different ways to present the way they see the world. And to illustrate that, I would have this. For quite a long time, those pictures were shown as an evidence of Germans burning down villages during the Second World War, and it was always stated by Russians. And only in the 90s, when a lot of things were declassified, it turned out that a lot of those pictures actually were pictures taken by Russians themselves, because they had to have proof that they were performing Stalin's order to burn down the cities and to take population away. Why I present this thing? Just to understand that quite often Russians, when they analyze threats, they think they are directed towards them, especially the modern threats. At the same time, they take those threats, they analyze them, they expand them, and they turn them into the tools to fight it back. So anytime when you read statements, you hear sayings of military brass, of academia, you have to think very carefully. Is it the way we still think about the threat, or is it already presenting the way to respond? And when we talk about hybrid things, Gerasimov is named a lot of times. But it's very, very interesting to observe that actually everyone, or mostly speakers rely on so-called Gerasimov's doctrine, the thing which does not exist according to my understanding, because it was the article of Gerasimov, where he analyzed the ways Western countries could fight Russia in the modern war. Based on what I just shown you, we could assume that it was taken, it was transformed, turned into the weapons, and brought back. But as I said, this was not only the occasion when such situations and threats were analyzed. Here you see, and you could read, so it would be even faster, that those kind of events, conferences, they go continuously in Russia. The last one was just a month ago, a lot of video conference, and there are a lot of statements made by military brass, by academia, related to how they see the threats which might come in the conditions of the modern warfare, how those threats should be taken, analyzed, expanded and turned into the weapons. And you see here that there is a talk going that only soft power like colorful revolutions or informational warfare or cyber warfare, it's not going to be the solution for the war. It would lead to a bigger war where the military, conventional military, would be very, very important. There are a lot of very interesting thoughts regarding the status of the country when, as you see in the bottom, Valoyevsky, the former chief of staff, also very bright general, says that actually the country is always in the war, which is very, very interesting observation, because here in the West, we prefer to think that we have peace and war. And based on those thoughts, looks like Russia is always in the war. And a lot of other statements which allow to understand us the way Russians think and what kind of means and tools they might design to fight us back. Like, for example, suddenly statements regarding capture of territories not being the most important one, but getting hearts and minds of people of neighboring countries, this is the most important thing. And a lot of other things, quite recently, for example, Gerasimov again talking about fifth column and Trojan horse. And you need to think, is it the way he says that the West is going to apply based on the message, on the speech? Looks like this is the case. But maybe Russians also working on that direction and transferring this already. So let's go and see. But based on those statements and also a lot of other ones, actually I came up with four wisdoms, as I call, of modern war fighting, which Russians use to analyze the situation and at the same time to design tools. And those are quite scary because, as I said, and you saw from the statements, Russians think that war is internal. It goes all the time, so country has to be in the war situation all the time. Russians not only think, but they do, and I will try to prove presenting some evidences, that war is fought not by the military of the state. It's being fought by entire state, and that's why all the military reform, establishment of National Defense Management Center, and a lot of other evidences show that they are following that principle. There are also a lot of evidences, and I will try to show you that actually when you wage the war, all the rules which were written before are not applicable. You design your own rules, you use them as long as they suit them. And as I already said, and you saw a couple of quotations, this is very, very dangerous thing also that they realize that in the recent modern world, to occupy physically territories is the last thing to be done. But first you have to get hearts and minds of the population. And you know, any time when Westerners tell about Russia performing that way, they sometimes become, let's say so, nervous and furious. And next fall I was attending OSCE meeting in Vienna. There, again, one of the country organized big seminar on Russian, the Gerasimov's doctrine, and Russians were presented. They, at first, it just happened, I was sitting behind them, so at first they were listening, later they started to laugh, later they became furious, and a couple of weeks later, the general from General Staff came to Vienna and delivered it to all the countries a presentation, and this is the slide, presenting them how they see the modern world, the modern war, and countries' participation. And as you see in the bottom here, there is a lot of different warfares and means mentioned. And here's a question mark. What is hidden here behind? So it was already mentioned that China is also the country and potential opponent for Russians. So Russians analyze China very much. China is also the country which produces own revolution and military affairs. And one of the things China is strong in is concepts, concepts of the war fighting, free warfares. And here, Russians took a note of that. This is what so-called media warfare, this is what we are right now emphasizing a lot in the West. This is cyber, this is informational warfare. But at the same time, Russians, while responding to that, we understood that there are a couple of other warfares which theoretically might be used against Russia. So to do a preemptive strike they think that it would be useful to do those things as well, psychological warfare, diminishing the will to resist, discrediting authorities of your potential opponent. Another type of warfare, legal warfare, exploitation of existing international rules and norms as long as they benefit them. They see those as a potential threats for them, and at the same time, as I said, they take them, they analyze them, they transfer them into their weapons. And allow me to present a couple of examples. As I already said, quite recently, actually, just a few weeks ago, Gerasimov was talking about fifth column. So the West might use fifth column in Russia to destroy Russian regime and to win the modern war. Let's see how Russians took that. As you see here, Russians also know that there is a fifth column in the Western countries, Russian fifth column. And as you see here, already back in 2013 and 15, they had huge programs designed, learning from British Council experiences, learning from American experiences. So we moved forward with cultural, historical, educational issues. And the task was very, very simple, to establish the fifth column by coordinated manner and to get as much as possible population in the foreign countries to be pro-Russian. So this is exactly what I meant by telling winning hearts and minds. But this is not the only thing. Besides that, Russians also have a sixth column, so-called agents, operatives from secret services, and we do have them. But again, there is a difference, and I'm not going to expand on that. The difference is very simple. Russians have ability to post or to send those agents to operate undercover for decades. For me, it would be very hard to imagine Western countries sending a spy with the fake live CV to stay in Russia for 25 years. I guess it would be not so many voluntaries. But Russians are very strong on that, and you see evidences here. When 10 Russian spies were captured in America, it turned out that some of them have been living in America for 20 years, for 30 years. So this is, again, the column which is able to gather information, but at the same time, it's an influential, influence agents. This is, at the same time, action agents, because some of them might succeed in the politics, in bureaucracies. So they are agents already able to act. Even more, authoritarian regimes are very, very keen to have loyal individuals. That's why there is so-called seven column, very dangerous thing, and usually we don't talk too much about that in the Western countries. Because here Russians took our values, the value of respect for individual, and transferred them into the weapon which is directed against us. There were a couple of British psychologists, Duning and Kruger, who back in late 90s wrote a study saying that there are some individuals which are born in such a way that they think that they are genius, even though they are far, far below the average. And here you see the graphs, how it is represented. And they just have the certain features. Those features are very useful if they are used as a weapon. At first, we are not able to take decisions. We try to complicate the situation. We postpone decisions. We like to have people similar to those surrounding them. So if you find them, if you promote them into the opponent societies, suddenly you have agents which are able to perform what I call soft or velvet sabotage. Those people are not able to make decisions on time, right decisions, and that's why the trust for the political leadership, for the state, for the military command is diminishing, the will to resist is diminishing. And you know, it's very, very difficult to name those people because, as I said, in the West, we take different approach to the individualities. But with your permission, I want to show a couple of pictures because I'm personally confident that those are one of the best representatives of the seven column. This is the former Ukrainian President Yanukovych, who had a lot of cronies around him, and the guy below is his general prosecutor, Pshonko. Those guys thought that they are very smart. They had extremes in their lives. For example, Pronko used to have an office room consisting of 7 different rooms. He was ordering paintings, him as Caesar. He was building luxury houses. And a lot of guys similar to this behavior were surrounding him. What was the result? When Crimea happened, suddenly it turned out that almost the majority of military personnel defected. The absolute majority of Secret Service officers defected because they did not trust anymore the political and military leadership. The National Security Council was not able to take decisions. So exactly this was the situation when the 7th column proved to be quite effective weapon. That's why Yanukovych was rescued, because it was your agent. You have to rescue them. So this is very, very interesting things which we should consider. Even sometimes we don't think about that, and even sometimes we think that it's not applicable to us. Another case showing how Russians might turn potential threats for them to the tools to fight. 2014, everyone knows what happened in Crimea, what consequences were in Crimea. But 2 weeks before Crimea, Russia managed to get territory 57 times bigger than Crimea under own control. And I bet you that not so many of you even don't know what territory I'm talking about. So this was Okhotsk Sea, because at that time, United Nations Maritime Commission took a decision that this claim of Russian Federation to have Okhotsk Sea as a domestic sea has a legal ground, has enough proof, and decision was taken. So actually, almost at the same time, Russia got 57 times bigger territory, almost not noticed. No sanctions were imposed during that, and Russians moved forward with establishing bases in the northern territories. So the result was that suddenly we lost quite huge territories because Russians very, very perfectly used a legal warfare. They thought that we might use this thing against them. They worked it, they transformed, and they used it. And the same thing is happening today with Arctics. They put the claim to Arctics as well at the same time. Of course, at that time it was refused. But look how situation is developing. They kept trying, they were presenting the evidences. Suddenly, quite recently, already the Maritime Commission said that Russian claim is almost to be approved for certain territories. And just a couple of weeks, a week ago, it was an Arctic seminar said, and all those things show that Russia is quite confident, because even without waiting the decision, they already said, it doesn't matter what decision is going to do. We are already strong in this field, and we're going to progress, move forward despite any things, any outcomes. That's why we have military bases established in Arctic already. That's why since January 1st this year, Russian Ministry of Defense established rules for the navigation. That's why just a week ago, finally, the Joint Strategic Command North was officially established. So all those things are not hidden. They are announced, and they show how we understand this modern war and how we apply those different modern warfare. There are a lot of other cases I could talk. All those riots caused by criminals, this means that it's also a way. There is also evidences of financial war being fought. In Lithuania, we had one bank bankrupted, Ukio Bank destroyed the same way. There are all those actions related to the involvement into the US elections, Skripal case. All those actions show that Russia applies a very wide range of means because it expects that the West also might apply them, even without thinking that there are some taboos in the West and we are even not going to do that. So just to finish my presentation, what I wanted to say and emphasize that Russia is fighting a modern war, not only taking the threats, but already fighting that. And she's not hiding it. She's officially showing that She's fighting. Why she is doing that thing? It's a different question, very interesting discussion, maybe to prove a status of great power, maybe to prove that she is smart and things like that. But the most important message what I want to deliver is that we have to be very cautious. All our values, all our beliefs, all our laws, actions are taken, explored, with the possibility to transform them into the weapon and to use against us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Davis. So we are about 10 minutes late, so that's my fault. So I will give up all my time as chair for you in the audience to have your say and have your comments and questions, should you have those. We have had four excellent presentations about threat perceptions and Russia's take on the world, its security, and the security environment around us. So we have a couple of microphones revolving here. So would you please raise your hand if you would like to pose a question and wait until you get the microphone. Over there, Antti Paronen.
Sirs, ma'am, I'm very pleased to hear from all of your insights. I'd have a question for Dr. Persson. How do you see Russia as a counterinsurgent actor or a anti-insurgent force compared to a conventional warfighter that you described in your insight? Thank you.
Okay, we take a couple of questions and then they get some answers to several of these. Are there any more questions in the audience? Back there, gentleman over there, would you please identify yourself?
Yes, thank you. Lieutenant Colonel Edward Caricato, military attaché of the United States Embassy. My question is regarding China's role in this. Is Russia's ability to leverage China to compel recognition, does that require us accepting a subordinate role to China? And if that's the case, how do you assess their willingness to accept such a subordinate role?
Thank you, sir. Any other questions for the first round? We still have a place at least for one question if you would like to have that. Okay, well, we'll start with the first two questions. I think the first one was addressed to Gudrun, to you, about Russia's take on counterinsurgency. So if you start.
Right, thank you.
I think it's managed. It's remote controlled, so.
Okay, regarding Russia's ability to fight terrorism, well, you can look at Chechnya as a prime example, not Northern Caucasus. It has been successful, if that is the word you want to use, in the sense that the most immediate terrorist attack within the heartland of Russia stops.
Yeah. Whoops. Did you hear that, or do you want me to repeat everything?
If you repeat it very quickly, thank you.
Pardon?
Can you just repeat very quickly, thank you.
Okay, if you're talking about Russia's capabilities as a counterinsurgent force, you can look at the North Caucasus for an example, and what has happened over the past 10 or 15 years is that the immediate terrorist attacks that plagued Russia right up until the Winter Olympics in 2014 has stopped. I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. And then we move to the China question. Michael, if you start.
The China question is a great question. So,
just push the button.
Yeah. Is it good now? Okay. Yep. I'm worried of the feedback sound. I'm afraid it might kill everyone here. It's happened before, believe me. If you speak enough, you've heard it. So the China question is a really good one. Two things. One, there's a relative Russian assessment that Russia's fundamentally resurgent vis-a-vis the United States. It's the strongest it's been since the dissolution of the Soviet Union, right? It was incredibly weak in the 90s and 2000s. So if there's a time to really take on the United States in terms of relative balance of power, this is it. But Russia at the same time is in decline relative to China, and they see that very well, given their expansion of Chinese economic and military power. So they have no option except for strategic partnership. As a result of the confrontation with the United States and the West, there are really no other strategic alternatives right now for Russia to begin with. Russia understands that all alliances are asymmetric. Somebody is a junior partner in most alliances. That's the reality of them, okay? And I can tell you somebody from the United States is essentially the dominant economic and military power. As much as you see countries as equal, at the end of the day, when it comes to the actual balance of power of allies and alliance, they're very asymmetric. Usually someone's the junior partner. From Russia's perspective, yes, they inevitably will be the junior partner in an alliance with China and the resource provider to them, which is exactly the deal they were being offered by the United States and the West, actually, to be the junior partner and the resource provider in Europe, with one important difference. The United States understood that the purpose of interaction and partnership with Russia would ultimately be Russia's democratic transition and conversion to democracy. That's the end of the current ruling regime. And the Russian ruling system of elites was not willing to concede to this implicit condition. China has no such requirements. So I think from Russian perspective, at least right now, one, they have no effective options for competing with China. Two, China makes a somewhat logical strategic partner, given they increasingly see that the United States is a bigger threat to them, Russia and China, than they are to each other, despite the fact that great powers always view each other apprehensively. And last but not least, there's increasingly a political assessment in Russia that ultimately Russia and China, while they have areas of competition, they are not over vital interests. And a lot of the Western sort of rhetoric about Russia, China competing in Central Asia, yeah, Central Asia is not exactly the super top priority in terms of Russian foreign policy, or it is China's either. And that there's areas of competition, but there's a big difference between vital areas of competition and non-vital areas of competition that can be managed. So I think from their perspective, they can manage it. The big question is how China will treat Russia. And there, and I will betray right off the bat my ignorance, I'm not a China expert. But I do not believe that China has a well-established history of alliance making, of external balancing with allies, and of treating other countries in any manner other than transactional or as subordinate states. So that very much remains to be seen, the kind of treatment Russia will receive from China. My view is that given the innate desire and drive for recognition and being given equal status, no matter what the actual balance of power is, that Russia would never accept such treatment, not from the United States, and certainly not from China, a country to which they only not so long ago felt incredibly superior to.
Thank you, Michael. Anybody else in the panel on the question of China? Yeah, Davis.
Permission. I took a different approach while trying to answer that question, because this is a very important question and very good question, but I decided to find the answer not staying in our shoes, but to transfer myself into the Russian shoes. And while analyzing the way they think about this situation, I came up with a couple of very interesting observations, which I might be wrong, might be right, it's up to you to decide. At first, especially after the Second World War, when even becoming victorious part, suddenly they lost the domination and the domination went to the United States, they realized and they fought and they provide a lot of statements regarding that, but it was due to the fact that America entered the war the last, because they don't give a serious role for the America's war with Japan. They still think that the major Second World War battlefields happened in Europe. So America was the third, the last to enter the war. And usually when you have two competitors fighting, usually as old proverb says, the third one wins. So they thought that this is the lesson to be learned. And very, very interestingly, but back in 2004, it was a very interesting conference held in Russia. It was a conference of Chinese specialists, and the title of conference was something like China and what Russia has to do with China, how it's supposed to deal, and things like that. And at that time, Putin attended that conference. It was quite material available in the open sources. But the message was very, very interesting. Experts came to the conclusion that sooner or later, the confrontation might happen between China and America. And in such a case, it would be for Russia a very wise approach to wait for the time to use the window of opportunity and to join as a third party on someone, or most preferably winning side, to get the benefits. And actually, at that time, it was said that, as it was mentioned here, Russians understood the Chinese are not willing to go to any alliances because of national features and characters, Russia, like not losing face and things like that. So Russians thought that they have to be patient to try to work out relations with both sides, to wait for the conflict to come, and later to get the winning position in such a case.
We go for the next round of questions in from the audience. Please raise your hand if you have any questions for the panelists. Over there, in the middle.
Arja Paane, Ilta-Sanomat. Russia is claiming those huge territories in Arctic, and they are quite confident that they will get them. But what if United Nations doesn't give them the right? What is going to happen in Arctic? Maybe all the panelists could answer.
Thank you very much. Then is there a second one in the audience? I have a written question from the audience, so I just would read it. So it said that, what is our understanding of the Russian threat perception concerning its attempts to enlarge its digital information and space presence? We have noticed some GPS jamming during, for example, military exercises. Do we or NATO need to safeguard our satellite information access in the near future? So that was the second question. And the third one, I would like to pose, and this will be the final round, can you just say your notions or your understandings about how does Russia conceptualize war? We have heard everything from all the levels of politics, legal things, media, information. It's going all the time. And on the other hand, what Michael was saying in the first keynote speech is that if there's going to be a war, it will go nuclear quite soon. So I think there's quite a big range that we are talking about. Where is the line between politics and war, and how do Russia conceptualize this? So we have three questions. So if we start in the order, so Petri, if you go first, and then we come through Gudrun, Davis, and Michael, the last one. These will be your last words this morning in this panel, so be brief. Thank you. Petri, you can start.
Arctic. I really can't answer this question, what Russia will do if UN won't allow them this Arctic as their domestic waters. So I don't think that they would use the violent options to start imposing their own sovereignty on that area, but that's something that we will see, but perhaps the other panelists are more wiser than me. What comes to this GPS, satellite navigation, and digital rights, how to impose our own rights on this area, I think the indication of violations is a vital role. I think that the Finnish response to alleged GPS jammings from Russia to Finland during the exercises last fall, it wasn't enough indicative that there was something happening. If somebody is hurting you, or attacking your country, or attacking your rights, you have to show that happened. I think that's something we have to do much more better next time. How to conceptualize a Russian approach towards war? When I read Russian theoretical papers, they are very traditional. They are very traditional, holding on ideas of Clausewitz, holding on ideas of Marx and Engels, and then Lenin. I think they think that the war is something. It's political thing. It's continuation of politics. And when the confrontation goes to that kind of phase that the opponent starts using violence, then it's war. And they also stress after long talks they have had in their own academical circles that the main way to wage war is still armed violence, but it's not the only way, but main way. So sometimes I am a little bit allergic on thoughts that every political debate is war.
Your turn.
Okay, thank you. I will start briefly on another note, ignoring the questions. And this was when we were discussing Dugin, Danilevsky, and Russian threat perceptions and what the military thought is at the moment. I must always remind myself that there is also another school of thought, if I simplify it a bit, in the Russian tradition. The problem now is that, first, no one listens to them, and secondly, they cannot publish as the one who are saying what the political and military leaders wants to hear. So that's a methodological lesson. There is a school saying that Russia can only be great if it doesn't have buffer state, if it focuses on its own development, the people, and the resources. We can talk about that during the break. Regarding the Arctic, there's, to my mind, there's a lot of hype at the moment. Russia is projecting, putting a few militaries, securing the military installations up there, and all of a sudden it's just very hype. So, and of course Russia will try to claim its interest, but interestingly enough, a recent proposal from the Russian side to ban all foreign vessels sort of failed because one of their own companies immediately asked for an exception to this rule since they were dependent on foreign vessels to get the LNG out. And also regarding the EU and NATO, I think it's EU and NATO, and EU has come in for the past 10 years since 2008 as seen as a big threat. And regarding the Great Deal, US-Russia, of course, that would be the ideal one. I agree with Michael on that. But there is also, if they cannot get that, there is a good enough option, to my mind. A good enough option would be if Russia could wage some discord within the EU, notably with, let's say, France, Germany, to sort of get a deal.
Yeah. Davis, for your final comments.
Regarding Arctic, you know, as I said, I am confident with Russians playing according with legal warfare rules in Arctic, as we did in Okhotsk, as we are trying to do in Azov, because due to the existing legal frame, they found the ways to get victory. And that's why they do a lot of geographical explorations in this area, gathering those proofs from the bottom of the ocean, so they could prove that this is a continental shelf. And according established rules today, this is the main argument to claim for the territories. Chinese did the same. They found another clue when the rocks belong to nobody, but if you have an island, this is already national territory. So they started to build islands. So this is, again, typical case of legal warfare. So the first, my statement is that I assume, and as you saw from the pictures here, given these snapshots from internet, most probably the Russian claim will be approved. Just, of course, not for so vast territories we expected in the beginning, because there are some other countries. And the second message which I want to say, that as you saw again from the internet picture snapshots taken, Russians, they don't worry too much about that, because they already started to act. They established those rules. Yes, it was right where some companies said that there are only some Western vessels to sail, so okay, they changed the rules. So right now, my requirement is to have a Russian representative on the ship. And they are placing those new defensive, as they call, systems. Air defense systems, they are building bases, they are moving, establishing the Joint Strategic Command North, which would have huge forces, including air and naval forces. So it's my answer for this. Regarding conceptualization of the war, I guess I already said that with those four wisdoms, Russians think that the war is undergoing right now, and they do a lot of things, and they use all those things in the real life, and there are a lot of things. Regarding electronic warfare and things like that, so, you know, they understood that electronic warfare is very, very powerful tool in the hands in the military. And so far, what we could do, there are only two potential ways to do. One of those, to take a defensive approach, and to get our equipment being protected and not sensitive to those weapons, or to take a mirror approach to start to apply the same thing to them, because so far they have exercises and they use those weapons, and impact is on our side, on our units and troops. When we do those exercises, we do not apply those weapons in a so wide scale, so it would be affected on their side.
Thank you very much. Michael, you have the final word.
Thank you. And once again, thanks for moderating us, Yuri. Briefly, on the Arctic, I agree with my colleagues. That subject is woefully oversubscribed in terms of interest relative to what's actually happening there. As far as the Arctic, from Russia's perspective, first of all, there's a bona fide military need from their point of view for what they're doing there. And if you follow the nature of aerospace warfare between Russia and the United States and strategic nuclear warfare, you can see why they reestablished a chain of strategic early warning radars, picket radars, air defense, and other military capabilities there. It's very logical and makes sense, given the modern character of war. Second, there's a strong economic investment believed by Russia that they can export their own LNG out of the Arctic. It's less about transit of other countries. It's more about export of their own energy first. How much of an economic rationale it has is unclear, but as always, the government loves to take the state budget and funnel money out of that into large infrastructure projects from which the key select people profit, which is how a patronage network works. And last but not least, Vladimir Putin personally cares about it. It's one of the two things that he really cares about it, and he's generally pretty bored with public administration. So there's a strong amount of interest kind of revolving around the Arctic, both in Russia and here, that exceeds the actual relative interest of what's happening there. As for what happens if Russia does not succeed through revisionism via international law, which I'm surprised people complain about, because that's actually the way countries ought to be doing it. The Crimea is a very good alternative if you like to see how great powers like Russia conduct revisionism outside of international law. Well, United States, we have a statement, which is possession is 90% of the law. When it comes to great power politics, possession is about 100% of the law. Okay? So that'll conclude on that. On electronic warfare, very briefly, it's really about Russian approach to attaining information superiority during the threatened period of conflict before the war, because you want to shape the environment prior to the actual onset of hostilities, and during the war. And that breaks out into sort of informational psychological means, not as exciting. More interestingly, information technical needs. And of course, as you know, information superiority is key for the modern conduct of war, because smart weapons need smart people to tell them smart things in order to be effective, unlike previous forms of warfare based on material attrition and lots of dumb weapons that were not guided. And whoever can attain information superiority and deny it to the adversary stands a much better chance on the whole, in the fight during the initial period of conflict. And finally, jury, I'll try to be very brief here, how do Russians conceptualize war? Well, during the original sort of opening statement, the way I tried to frame it is, war is a contest of political and military systems. From a political perspective, it is always a contest of wills. It is a contest of wills between two states. Political will can be attacked, it can be shaped. You can definitely target what you believe to be an asymmetry of interest at stake with the adversary. Are we good? The other part of it is the military system, which is that at the end of the day, a military is a functional system. It has nodes, it has modules. It is not a fight based on attrition of just tanks and aircraft and missiles. It is a fight based on targeting critical objects that you think the other side needs to actually sustain a campaign. And I talk about theater of nuclear warfare. That's actually the good news. You know, for most of the Cold War, the Soviet general staff expected that the conventional phase of the campaign in Europe would last somewhere between 2 to 10 days, over, under, prior to theater nuclear exchange and then strategic nuclear exchange, right? But for sure, they expected Europe to end up looking like a glass parking lot. I'll be very blunt about that. So that was the good news, and that's why they didn't do it. Today, after 1980s debates, particularly views of Marshal Agarkov, Russia has really come to accept that there is a space for a limited conventional war between great powers that may last some weeks. And those some weeks can buy the opportunity and the time for actual escalation management prior to nuclear escalation. But they also believe now in a much more limited theater nuclear option in terms of nuclear employment. Again, thinking that the role of theater nuclear weapons is principally escalation management. But we've never gone away from it. All right. In fact, from Russia's perspective, this is an evolution on the nature of, and character of war between great powers. Russia has not and will never accept, no matter how many precision-guided conventional weapons they buy, that warfare between great powers who have nuclear weapons will be conventional only. Okay? I'd like to close on that.
Well, thank you, Michael, and thank you for all the panelists. As we are already ahead of a little bit behind schedule, so would you please all join me in giving an applause for all of our panelists? Next we will have a ridiculously short coffee break. It's 15 minutes according to the program, so we will continue at 11:25. We are going to have two sessions running at the same time. So those who are going to Cyber One, you need to change the building to Ritaritalo. There are signs outside. And those who will continue on Security Policy One panel, you will stay here in this auditorium. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to finalize this seminar. We are turning now, by the aviation terms, to the final leg of our joint effort. First, I would like to give some administrative remarks. We are spreading out feedback forms by our assistants. Please, if you haven't filled them out, do it during this last lecture. And there are boxes outside of the election hall that you can leave your feedback. If you have open feedback, you can use the turn of the paper and write up poems or whatever. And I would claim that all nations use selected and edited historical narratives to shape their identity and to emphasize their specificity. In Finland, historical narratives are derived from the ancient stories how pagan Finns received invaders from the West and East and met new religion called Christianity. Of course, we Finns, we don't recall the events that when we evicted indigenous Sami people from their own lands. Today, Finnish patriotic narratives are getting their empowerment from the Russification era in the Grand Duchy of Finland in the turn of 19th and 20th century. However, the most important narrative is the survival campaign of newly independent Finland against the Soviet invasion during the Winter War 1939-1940. Such narratives are easy to turn as enemy images if so decided. One of the key narratives in the Russian history follows the theme of Christianization of Russia. I have noticed that the use of ancient narratives is not unfamiliar to President Vladimir Putin. After the illegal annexation of Crimea, he referred to the baptism legend of Prince Vladimir in Chersonesus 988. Last year, President Putin got my attention in the television document about the monastery of Valamo, Valam in Russian. It's located on an island of Lake Ladoga, not so far away from the Russo-Finnish border areas. I was startled when I noticed that Putin referred to the oldest and also the
most unconvincing known hagiography about the birth of the monastery. According to this legend, a holy place was blessed by the disciple of Jesus, Apostle Andrew, the first called himself. According to the monastery's present history, which is represented by the monastery and the whole Russian Orthodox Church, the cloister was brought up a millennium later by the monks St. Sergius and St. Herman. I think I saw a slight flash of disbelief on the faces of modern monks when they listened to their statehead. President Putin continued his analysis on the similarities of communism and Christianity and the humane attitude towards the people. In reality, Soviet rule did it best, trying to destroy the church and freedom of any confession but Marxism-Leninism. Kati Barpei from the University of Eastern Finland leads us today into Russian national narratives which could be used as raw materials for enemy images. I think we are all familiar with the current Russian trend of stressing victory of the Second World War, in Russian terms, Great Patriotic War, and the effort to resist so-called falsification of the history of that war. This attempt is even perceived so important that in 2009, Russia established a special presidential commission to counter attempts to falsify history to the detriment of Russia's interests. I'm interested to know if and how this special committee of wise scholars reached their objectives with such a base that committee was dissolved after 3 years of work in 2012. Kati holds the title of docent in Russian history, and her main area of research is the formation of national interest in Karelia and Russia before Russian Revolution. I hope that we may connect past and present patterns of enemy images in Russia and have the food for thought how to avoid destructive thinking in our own society. It's not opposed to a stiff commitment of defending one's sovereignty, as well as global values, human rights, international law, and our environment. Kati, floor is yours.
So, good afternoon, and thank you for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me here. It has been a very interesting day. It has also been a very long day, and I seem to have this ungrateful task of finishing it by covering some thousand years of Russian history in half an hour. But I'm not going to be very comprehensive in any way, obviously. But instead, I will try to give a very simplified outline with some examples of the development of enemy images in Russian national narrative. I'm a historian, but instead of events, I have always been more interested in so-called meta-history. And by that I mean the way the past is represented at each given time in each given context. And Russia is an especially interesting case study. Even though history politics and use of history are a universal phenomena, the national narrative in Russia leans especially heavily on the images of the past. And I would say that basically, in order to understand Russia's present geopolitical tendencies and the way it perceives its enemies nowadays, and perhaps also the relationship between the Orthodox Church and the secular power structure, it's very helpful to take a look at the past, even as far as to the Middle Ages. It may not be essential, but I think it helps. And the time is short, so I'm going to be very selective in choosing my examples. So, first, we will shortly examine an idea called othering as for a basis for discussion about enemy images. And then I'm going to take a short look on the enemy images in medieval text production, all the way to the 16th century, because it indeed lays a certain foundation for perceiving the threat posed by so-called hostile others in Russia. Next, my focus will be on the 19th century, because it's the main period of the formation of the national narrative and ideas of Russianness in relation to other nations. And this holds true especially to certain military events, we will take a look at. And then I'll take a very short look on the Second World War and the idea of the continuing resistance. And finally, I will say a couple of concluding words in the context of post-Soviet and contemporary Russian history politics. I will start with a quote by Gregory Carleton, whose book Russia, The Story of War, was published in 2017. And this quote quite neatly summarizes my message today. Quote, "National identity so defined assumes that history, at least for Russians, repeats itself, extending back for centuries to a pattern of confrontation in which the actor's name may change, but not the primary action. It flattens differences, turning sui generis conflicts into a single paradigmatic one that pits Russians against an implacable foe, where they are always the victims, but never the vanquished. Victory always obtains. Russia always comes back." End of quote. And this quote actually describes this process of othering, of which Katri already talked about a bit. It means that group identities, in this case national identities, are formed in relation to others. So basically, by describing the other, we actually describe ourselves. And by describing the other, especially the enemy, with negative attributes, we actually embrace their positive counterparts. That is, what the others are, we are not, and what we are, the others are not. And in representations of conflicts, this is a basic feature of some sort, this antithesis of heroes and villains. Us as victims of military provocation or other wrongdoing, and they as merciless assailants, the enemies. And this process of othering is, of course, also a universal one. Every single national narrative has certain echoes of this thinking, the purpose of which is to consolidate the inner cohesion. And this is a very important issue, this inner cohesion, this inner internal unity. So first to the Middle Ages. Medieval texts in the area of Russia have been preserved from the 14th century onwards. And chronicles and other texts were written and copied by monks and other churchmen. And their worldview is very dualistic, it's very black and white. Us in them means exclusively Orthodox Christians. And all the other groups, such as pagan peoples from the steppe and forest, and for instance Roman Catholics, belong to the category of others. So it was religion that formed the dividing line between us and them. But it's interesting to note that most of the encounters, even the military encounters with the others, are described quite unemotionally and in a very laconic way in the chronicle texts. There are no pejorative attributes attached to the others. But that changes when descriptions of yet another ethnic group begin to emerge, the Tatars. The Novgorod First Chronicle, which is preserved from the 15th century, describes an invasion that took place in 1223. Quote, "The same year, for our sins, unknown tribes came, of whom no one exactly knows who they are, nor whence they come from, nor what their language is, nor of what race they are, nor what their faith is, but they call them Tatars." End of quote. And as you probably know, the Russian historiography uses the concept Tatar yoke, Tatarskaya Iga, to refer to the Mongol or Tatar domination of the area that is nowadays known as Russia from the 13th to 15th century. And in these medieval texts, Tatars weren't called not just pagans, but also those of other faith, faithless, godless, Hagarenes, Ishmaelites, to mention but a few names. So these names are all about the religion, this dividing line. And the damage caused by Tatars in Russian towns and villages is depicted in a very detailed and very graphic way in the texts. So from this slide, remember this dualism, this tendency of dichotomies. But what is interesting to our team today is what happened then. In the 1550s, Tsar Ivan IV, known as Ivan the Terrible, conquered the Khanates of Kazan and Astrakhan. And also during the 16th century, the image of Tatars was consolidated into one of archenemy of Moscow and the Orthodox Church. In real life, of course, these relationships between different ethnic and religious groups were much more complex, but the contemporary text production was, as during the previous centuries, very dualistic and black and white in these matters. And especially one military encounter called Battle of Kulikovo was hailed as some kind of prototype of the warfare and resistance against Tatars and Islam with the support of the Orthodox Church. The battle had taken in 1380 between the coalition led by the Grand Prince of Moscow, Dmitry Ivanovich, and Tatar Emir called Mamai. And the first accounts of the battle were very short and laconic. But the interesting thing is that they kept growing and getting more detailed with every round of rewriting and copying. So finally, in the 16th century, this event was described as almost an apocalyptic battle between good and bad forces, paving the way to the liberation of the land of Rus from the Tatar yoke. And by that time, in the 16th century, Moscow had consolidated its position as the leader of the principalities of the area. So the message of these edited and interpolated battle stories emphasized the leadership of Moscow and the unity of Russian principalities against a common threat. So here we come to the main purpose of enemy images, this inner cohesion. So it can be said that the dualistic worldview was now completed with ideas of unity and central power. Also, the first compilations of the history of Moscovite ruling dynasty were produced during that period. For the first time, Russian past was represented as an imagined continuum, which was seamlessly intertwined with the contemporary power structure. And in these compilations, these compiled histories, the already established imagery concerning Russia's relations to its others was further consolidated. For instance, Grand Prince Alexander Nevsky's victories against Swedes and Livonians in 1240 and 1242 were turned into reference points for military encounters with the Western enemies, such as Lithuania at the time. And the hero of the Battle of Kulikovo, Dmitry Ivanovich, who was called Donskoy from the 16th century onwards, became a symbol for the resistance against Eastern enemy. So these two warrior figures were symbolically paired to represent the defenders of the fatherland against Eastern and Western threat. And what is especially important to note is that these compilations written in the 16th century were used as the main sources for national history writing from the 18th century onwards. So all the 16th century imagery laden with contemporary meanings was quite neatly transferred to the national narrative information. And here we have a very interesting symbolic representation of these contemporary ideas. It's an icon called Blessed Be the Host of the Heavenly Tsar, Blagoslovenna Voinstvo Nebesnogo Tsarja. It was painted in Moscow in 1552 to commemorate the conquest of Kazan. And on the right side of the icon, there is Kazan, which is burning. And on the left side, there is Moscow, or rather Moscow as New Jerusalem, the holy city, with the Mother of God receiving these victorious warriors. And the host is led by Archangel Michael, and it has been interpreted that amongst the military figures following him are forefathers of Ivan IV, such as Alexander Nevsky and Dmitry Donskoy. So this icon is laden with political meanings. There would be lots of interesting things to discuss and layers of meanings to examine, but now let's take a longer leap forward. During the 18th century, the question of Russia's position in relation to Europe and Asia had started to emerge. Before that, there wasn't really discussion about these geopolitical matters. At the end of the century, the Russian elite leaned very much to the French culture. They spoke French and everything French was highly valued, as you probably know. But this all changed in 1812, when Napoleon's troops invaded Russia all the way to Moscow. Russians did gain a victory, but this invasion caused a deep collective trauma, so to say. And in the texts produced right after these events, Napoleon was compared to historical evildoers, such as Attila the Hun and Xerxes, who was a Persian emperor, and also infamous Tatar invaders, such as Batu, Mamai, and Tohtamish. So it can be said that an already well-established image of arch-enemies was now applied to another sort of invaders. By that time, the Tatars, this original enemy, had been assimilated into Russian Empire, and the other threat had now come from the other direction, from the West. And it's very interesting to note how in this text about this invasion, a very medieval rhetoric is once again used. Russians are represented as God-loving people who defended their fatherland against an evil invader. And Napoleon is even compared to Antichrist. And these events took place at the same time with the rise of the nationalistic ideas in Russia as well as in Western Europe. And the admiration of everything French gradually changed into interest towards everything Russian. And also it was thought that Russia had both fought against the whole Europe in the form of Napoleon's troops, but also saved it from Napoleon. So Russia kind of embraced the role of savior because of these events. And these events of 1812 actually formed a kind of foundation for Russia's further ponderings of its role in relation to other nations, and especially to Europe. And also intertwined with these processes, national history writing and national narrative began to form from the 19th century onwards, or actually from the end of the 18th century onwards. And as I mentioned, these 16th century texts were used as main sources. And indeed, their message emphasizing the inner cohesion and strong central power supported with the church was as topical as ever in the 19th century Russian Empire, as you can imagine. And here is a print depicting Napoleon, actually with Satan. And these cheap Lubok prints were one of the tools to distribute images and ideas to larger audience, along with school textbooks. Literacy rate was growing, so people were able to read textbooks and also printed media. So it can be said that while during the earlier centuries, images of the past or of the enemies had been so-called elite images. They had been produced by the elite and also consumed by the elite, but now they began to turn into truly collective ones. A very good example of this development is the Russo-Turkish War in 1877-78. And it was actually the first military event that was effectively marketed to people, so to say. Lots of cheap, popular booklets were published depicting the military events at the Balkans. And the purpose of these publications was to promote the war and to get volunteers to fight in the war and people to donate money for the war. And in the spirit of Pan-Slavism, the authors of these booklets emphasized the Russians' duty to help the Balkan Slavs to fight against the Turkish tyranny. And the booklets presented the reader with very colorful, very graphic depictions of the horrors performed by the Turks in Slavic villages. And they were full of representations of Turks as a wild, unorganized, lazy, and immoral people, as opposed to hardworking and pious Slavs, the brothers in faith and tribe for Russians. So here is a very good example of this othering process, an enmification process, which we were talking about in the beginning. So all the negative features were applied to the enemy and the positive ones were embraced by us, the Orthodox Slavs in this case. It is interesting that the authors of these booklets didn't really mention any recent events, such as, for instance, the Crimean War of 1853-56. But instead, they chose to contextualize the campaign in Balkans in Russian national narrative and Orthodox Christians' historical battle with Muslims. And it's not very surprising that these Tatar invasions were the most popular reference point, even though in this case the enemy wasn't invading Russia. And the Battle of Kulikovo was also mentioned in many occasions. So these depictions once again leaned on the already established imagery of Muslims as the arch enemy and threat to Orthodox Russians and Slavs in general. And once again, very medieval rhetoric was in use. And also, as in the case of Napoleonic Wars, Russia was once again presented as a lonely and selfless defender of Christian faith. The West, which referred to Western European countries, was represented as an ally to Turkey and more interested in its own profit than defending the helpless Balkan Christians. Around the same time, philosopher and historian Nikolai Danilevsky published his Pan-Slavist writings on Russia and Europe. And he asserted that Russia had never been an aggressor in its dealings with its neighbors. He wrote, I quote, "And so the composition of the Russian state, the wars it waged, the goals it pursued, and even more, the frequent favorable circumstances it never utilized, all show that Russia is not an ambitious, aggressive power, and that in the modern period of its history, it most often sacrificed its own obvious gains, which were legal and just, to European interests, often even considering that its responsibility was to act not as an independent entity with its own significance and its own justification for all its actions and aspirations, but as a secondary power. So why, I ask, should there be such distrust, injustice, and hatred toward Russia from the governments and public opinion of Europe?" End of quote. And if this quote sounds familiar, it may be because very similar claims have been presented by Russian leaders even quite recently. But I will soon get to that. During the first decades of the Soviet system, national history with its images of enemies was paid generally less attention to than during the 19th century, because there were other things to do at that time, internal enemies to concentrate on, and so on. But the World Wars, and especially the second one, called once again for reference points from the national past to encourage and raise the morals of the troops. For instance, Alexander Nevsky and Dmitry Donskoy, this pair of warrior heroes, a medieval pair of defenders of the fatherland, were brought out by Joseph Stalin as brave examples for Soviet soldiers. And Dmitry was also a topic of a propaganda poster, which reminded that death was better than honorless life. And these propaganda posters are a topic of its own. It's a very interesting topic. But I have chosen only these two to show you, because they illustrate the idea of military history of Russia as a continuum. On the left, there is this one with a quote from Dmitry and medieval warriors supporting the Soviet ones. And on the right is another with quite a similar theme. It reminds the soldiers that they are grandchildren of Suvorov, children of Chapayev. And Suvorov was a military hero of the 18th century and Chapayev a commander of Red Army in the First World War. And as you can see, there is a medieval warrior also in the picture, joining the resistance. And one can say that certain echoes of this medieval dualism can still be detected in the Second World War rhetoric. Of course, fascism was the main enemy, and the Soviet ideology fought against it with the same devotion than previously the defenders of the fatherland supported by the Orthodox Church. And later on, during the Cold War, it can be said that the capitalist West, the United States in the first line, formed the most significant ideological opponent of the Soviet system. So finally, I'm going to ponder a bit the situation of post-Soviet in the post-Soviet and contemporary Russia in the context of what I have been saying. That is, in the context of the continuum of national narrative and enemy images. It indeed seems that the idea or ideal of national collective understanding of history, the great national narrative, is important for contemporary Russian power circles. This can be seen in the presidential speeches, in which the national past and its heroes are often referred to. Not just the recent history, but the whole span of this continuum of the collective past. For instance, President Putin has announced, quote, "In order to revive national consciousness, we need to link historical eras and get back to understanding the simple truth that Russia didn't begin in 1917 or even in 1991, but rather that we have common continuous history spanning over 1,000 years, and we must rely on it to find inner strength and purpose in our national development." End of quote. And as a part of this same trend, there has been this prominent question of falsification of history, which Professor Lalu already referred to. Especially the Second World War in Russia is depicted once again as a scene of undisputed Soviet or Russian heroism and sacrifice. And any attempts to reevaluate the Soviet-induced history have called for reactions, such as the founding of the Presidential Commission. The foundation of this commission, as well as the project of producing unified school history textbooks, are prime examples of attempts to control the ideas of the past in contemporary Russia. Those attempts, however, have been explicitly represented as reactions to others' attempts to contort the past. For instance, in 2017, President Putin warned against falsifying and manipulating history as a threat to world order. And along with the same line, the idea of Russia as a reactive rather than militarily active nation is brought out implicitly and explicitly. So Russia is seen as a victim and savior rather than an aggressor of any sort. As we saw, for instance, Danilevsky put that idea into words already in the 19th century. And in the presidential speeches, it's often emphasized that Russia doesn't attempt to wage war, but instead tries to work as a peacekeeper, while other nations refused to do their part in, for instance, for disarmament. So Russia is forced to defend its interests. The foundation of these theme parks called Russia, My History, Russia, Moya Istoria, in numerous cities around Russia, sends this message of national innocence to Russian people. And this project of founding these theme parks is close to the power structure, is carried out by instances that are close to the power structure and the church. And in these parks, there is a very impressive multimedia show that takes the visitor all the way from the Middle Ages to the present day and its challenges. And it's interesting that only very limited amount of English translations are available, so the target group is not tourists, it's Russians, and especially school children and youth. So it can be said that these parks are like patriotic indoctrination, par excellence. And the firm cooperation of the state and the Orthodox Church is once again emphasized in these theme parks. And the whole history of Russia is presented as a very coherent narrative, excluding any optional interpretations or questions. So, as I said before, themes like unity, strong leadership, and kind of dualistic worldview have been very usable themes all the way from the Middle Ages to the present. And they have been updated to respond to contemporary needs of each given time. Should I finish now, or do I still have a couple of minutes?
Yes, you have.
Okay. So I will say a couple of concluding words about our main theme, the enemy images. So what can we say about them in today's Russia? There are much better experts here than me in that matter, but here are some thoughts anyway. Apparently, Russia still needs some outer enemies in order to enhance unity, maybe even more than for a long time. And as I said in the beginning, othering is essential for creating and maintaining collective identities. So the target group for any image formation or maintenance is the people of Russia. And one interesting detail is that despite of the rise of the significance of the Orthodox Church in the contemporary politics in Russia, Muslims are sort of outdated as arch enemies. Because for the sake of this inner cohesion of modern-day Russia, it would be very unwise to pinpoint any Islamic groups as a threat. No Russian leader wants to annoy, for instance, Tatars, and maybe encourage ethno-nationalism in Tatarstan. Instead, any extremism is presented as a threat, referring to terrorist acts and separatist movements. And for me, it also looks like the fascists have been resurfaced as a potential enemy image, at least on a symbolic level. And this can be seen, for instance, in the lavish Victory Day celebrations, as well as in the tendency to see these competed versions of the past, those falsified histories, as a serious threat. So in a way, a historical threat is brought firmly into today by these activities. And of course, this seems to be firmly intertwined with the contemporary geopolitics and general attitudes towards West. These competed borders, as in the case of Ukraine, have called accusations of fascism in Russia. And this had been intertwined with bringing out these liberal values and decadence of the West at the same time. But this is a very complicated discourse of its own, so I will end my presentation here. And I hope that you have some ideas of this, these issues. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, dear audience, now you have we have time for brief question and answers sessions for Kati. So please, questions. Yes, please.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. My name is Dylan Fisher. I'm with the U.S. Embassy in Helsinki. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if you see these enemy images as it relates to Russia's involvement in Ukraine.
Not maybe straight involved, but I think it's in the case of Ukraine, these old ideas of West as the opponent, I think they have been like reused again. So in a way, there are echoes of these old enemy images, I think. They are quite easily revived. There is this array of images that can be applied to new situations. But when it comes to, for instance, these old arch enemy images, then maybe it's not so relevant. But when it comes to West, it will definitely, as it's quite obvious.
Any more questions? Yes, please.
Hi, thank you very much for your presentation. It was very fascinating. I have a question about the enemy images stemming from history and especially the Russian wars with Sweden in the past. So in your research, have you ever come across these kind of enemy images still stemming from the historical conflict with Sweden? And maybe if it carries across to Russia's relationship with Sweden today?
It's very interesting that in medieval chronicles, of course, there are depictions of military encounters with Swedes and Jutes, which refers to Finno-Ugrian groups. But they are very laconic. There are no pejorative features attached to Swedes, for instance. And in general, I think I haven't really seen any significant depictions of Swedes as some kind of stereotyped enemies. I think Lithuanians have been like more prone to those depictions. But definitely Swedes are like a part of this. And actually, I have a colleague who is studying these issues from the Swedish side, and we have been thinking about some co-written article about it. But at this point, I have to say that no, Swedes don't like stand up as enemies, which is quite interesting, actually.
Any other questions, please? Antti Paronen.
Ma'am, thank you for your presentation. Regarding extremism, do Russians see extremism as an inner threat or a threat as well as an outside as well? If outside, do they consider themselves as a part of to countering that threat as well? Thank you.
I think that is something that someone else can answer better than me, but I would say that they consider it more like an inner threat. But if there is someone who can say something about this, then I would very gladly hear about it. Because I'm not really an expert of these contemporary issues. But I think they're also intertwined, these outer and inner threats nowadays, so they can't be completely separated, I would say.
We have still time for a question. Yes, please.
Thank you very much for the very interesting presentation. My name is Päivinikainen, and I would be interested in understanding when you say that there is this continuum from the history, from medieval history for the enemy images. How does that link to, in your mind with the Romanov history of the Russian Tsars and then the revolution and all the way to the common day? So you had to jump, I understand, but maybe you would like to say a couple of words. How do you put them together, please?
I think that there is definitely this idea of continuing Russian power. And the starting point is the 16th century with these historical compilations, but I think that in general it was very easy to continue those continuums afterwards, like for instance during Romanov times. So there definitely is some sort of idea of Russian power that is in a way eternal and it continues and goes on and on. But it's also a very interesting topic and definitely worth examining closer.
Okay, I take the opportunity to take a last question. So what happened to this presidential committee against falsification of history? Did they reach their goal, or was there another reason for this abandonment of this project?
Well, I have to say that I really don't know, but what I do know is that this question of falsification is still quite acute in Russia when it comes to Eastern European countries and also even to Finland. But when it comes to that commission, I don't know. Is it still existing? I don't know. They seem to pop up and then, I don't know. Haven't heard anything about it for a while.
Okay, thank you, Kati. We go towards closing remarks. Niklas von Bunsdorf, Director of External Affairs, please.
Herra Kendali, hyvät naiset ja herrat, mina damer och herrar, ladies and gentlemen. I have the honor to deliver the closing remarks after a very rewarding day. Closing remarks, the last words before the wine reception. No worry, I will be brief. Ladies and gentlemen, as Director for External Relations, I have been all smiles today. the vision of the National Defense University is to be a nationally and internationally networked forerunner, if I may say, on military science education and research. I think the seminar today is a great example of the work in support of this vision. It has, of course, first and foremost, provided the possibility of expert-level talks on an ever-interesting subject. Secondly, it has presented a wonderful platform for the university and for the interaction the university has with the society in Finland and internationally. We have had some 200 participants on site and many more following us online. I thank you all for coming, for spending the day here with us, and thank all for their participation. This is a series of events, therefore we are very thankful for the feedback that you provide us with so that we can improve our events also in the future. I urge you to follow the Defense University's social media and our media publications to be a standby for further and future events as well. So, follow MPKKFI for more information. There will now be more thank yous. Thank you and congratulations to the organizing team. You have conducted a very rewarding seminar. Professor Lalu, Assistant Professor Pynnöniemi, Lieutenant Colonel Peso, the whole Russia team. I thank Suvi Manelius, Elina Suominen, and our media team for providing an extensive coverage of our the event. There's been lots of social media activity this whole day, worth to mention. I thank all other amazing people that have contributed, including the Guard Jäger Regiment, the guides that we have had outside, the Guard and the band that we will hear in just a few minutes, I hope. Of course, cannot thank our financial supporters enough that have provided resources for the event as well. But now I turn to the performers from today. We have had a great group of excellent panelists. I thank each and every one of you for sharing your insights with us. I know that you are dispersed here in the room. We heard two keynote speeches. Mr. Michael Kaufman on threat perception, and we concluded now with Kati Parpe's presentation speech on images, enemy images in this case. Symbolically, we would like to ask, well, Mr. Kaufman, he has already left the building, so he cannot attend. He was already noted. But we would like the keynote speaker, Kati, would you please come forward? And symbolically accept a present that I would please ask General Kallio to hand over. Alina, will you please assist? And one for the camera as well. Let this wooden chopping board with the contours of our beloved nation be a lasting memory for today. Thank you, Kati. Finally, I would like to thank all of you for your activity. I'd like to wish you all a safe return to your home bases, wherever they are. And with these words, I conclude the seminar. I suggest you give yourselves the loudest applause so far. Thank you.